Well, welcome everybody. I'm really delighted to have the opportunity to introduce Jack Shaw to you today. He is a futurist and one of the best in the world. He's been a technology futurist for more than 30 years, helping others understand the strategic implications of emerging technologies. He's the author of 3 books and numerous articles and white papers. He's delivered more than 1,000 paid keynote addresses and executive presentations in more than 20 countries. He was voted one of the world's top 5 technology futurist speakers by over 12,000 meeting planners, executives, and conference attendees. His clients include IBM, SAP, Oracle, GE, and Coca-Cola, among hundreds of other businesses and public sector organizations, large and small. He's widely recognized for his expertise in such breakthrough business technologies as artificial intelligence, blockchain, 3D printing, and the Internet of Things. Jack graduated from Yale and has an MBA from Kellogg. He's lived in Atlanta for over 30 years. He has 3 children and 2 grandchildren, and he enjoys fine dining, good wines, and the exercise he needs to work them off. Welcome, Jack.
Thank you very much. Jack Shaw. This is the Queen Elizabeth. The original QE1, for those of you that are keeping track. For 50 years in the first part of the 20th century, she and her sister ocean liners dominated the market for North Atlantic business passenger transportation. If you wanted to travel between, say, New York and London, you went by ship. Now, by the late 30s, it had become possible to fly commercially across the Atlantic, but as the executives of the ocean liner business would have told anyone willing to listen, who would want to subject themselves to 18 to 30 hours of rattling, shaking, noisy, smoky discomfort when traveling by ocean liner? You could ride in comfort, indeed in luxury, and arrive at your destination in less than a week. No, they said, business people will always cross the ocean by ship. And so it was until August of 1957, when Pan American Airlines introduced Boeing 707 nonstop jet service from New York to London in 8 hours. And in 6 months, the North Atlantic ocean passenger transportation business lost 90% of its revenues. Mm-hmm. Disruptive emerging technologies can have a rapid and profound impact on business. We are not currently facing a disruptive emerging technology. We are facing at least 5 different, simultaneous, disruptive, emerging technologies. Now, as a technology futurist, I have always tried to pay close attention to the wisdom of that great American, Yogi Berra, who put it so well when he said that making predictions is very hard, especially about the future. Nevertheless, I'm going to go out on a limb and make some predictions for you today. So I'd like to paint a scenario for you. It's a beautiful day. Just a few years from now, a passenger jet sits at the end of the runway at Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris, awaiting clearance to take off to Atlanta. It's cleared and takes off. Some 3 hours later, a jet fuel injector for one of the engines. Sensors embedded in the injector notice that it has reached a critical point of wear, and that while it is going to be perfectly safe and functional for the rest of the flight, it must be replaced before the plane can fly back to Paris. Now, back in the old days, back in 2016, That would have meant taking that aircraft out of service for at least several hours, probably a day or more. But in the digitally transformed business ecosystem of this time, just a few years from now, that won't be necessary, as you'll see. Instead, using the Internet of Things communications capabilities also embedded within the jet fuel injector, it communicates with the aircraft's autonomous maintenance system, notifying it of the circumstances. The aircraft's maintenance system, in turn, communicates with the airline's global maintenance system to let it know that this part is going to have to be replaced on arrival in Atlanta. Now, as it happens, in order to optimize inventory carrying costs, this particular part, which rarely needs to be replaced, is not kept on hand at the airport in Atlanta. Again, back in the old days, that would have meant flying the part in from another airport or another vendor and still further delays. Instead, what happens is that the airline's global maintenance system sends a requisition for this part to the airline's global procurement system. The airline's global procurement system then launches an intelligent request for bid agent out onto the internet, which scours thousands of sites of potential suppliers for this particular part, identifying several that are capable of providing a version of this part fully certified and authorized for use with this engine on this aircraft. The intelligent agent then negotiates with the intelligent order management agents of each of those suppliers to try to determine which one can provide the best terms and conditions for the airlines at this particular point in time. It ends up identifying a particular one that is offering the best pricing and terms, and they, the two agents, conclude a contract digitally recorded on the blockchain. This smart contract then authorizes the intelligent global maintenance system of the airline to download the design for a 3D printed version of this particular part to the airline, which is loaded into a 3D printer at the Atlanta airport, which begins printing out this part. This entire process, from the time that the jet fuel injector's sensors detected reaching a critical point of wear until the completion of the successful download of the 3D printed design, has taken a total of 7 minutes, about half of which was used for the download of the multiple gigabit 3D design file. Now, back in the old days, it would have taken a good number of hours to print out this particular part. But by this time, the part is able to be printed out, finished, and delivered to the gate that the aircraft is scheduled to arrive at 2 hours before the arrival of the aircraft. When the aircraft arrives, the passengers disembark, the aircraft is cleaned and refueled, and at the same time, one of the aircraft maintenance engineers swaps out the new part for the old part. Now, this particular aircraft maintenance engineer is quite knowledgeable and experienced, but it happens that she's never had the opportunity to replace this particular part on this particular aircraft before. Never mind, it doesn't matter, because using the replay through her augmented reality goggles, it walks her step by step through the part replacement process, projecting a three-dimensional image of exactly what needs to be done in each step onto the actual physical parts involved in the process, and recording, making a video recording of the replacement for documentation purposes. At the conclusion, once that part is snapped into place, it automatically sets off a self-test procedure to make sure that the part is working properly and communicating effectively with the rest of the engine, through the Internet of Things capabilities and with the rest of the aircraft's systems. When it notifies the aircraft that it has been self-tested properly and is working, the aircraft's maintenance system updates that information into the airline's global maintenance system, which shares that information with the global procurement system, which informs the smart contract that the new part has been successfully installed, causing the smart contract then to trigger payment from the airline to the vendor for the part that was just installed. Now, this is a little different from the way things work today in many different respects. Let me ask you a question. Which one of these technologies is the one that enabled the digital transformation of the process? How many people would say it was the Internet of Things capabilities that have enabled this digital transformation of this aircraft maintenance ecosystem? How many people would say it was the artificial intelligence agents capabilities? Maybe the blockchain functions?
What's blockchain?
By the way, how many people here are familiar with blockchain technology? How many people here have heard the word blockchain technology before today? Okay, some of you have heard it. We'll talk a little bit more about what the blockchain is in a few minutes. That's pretty much the answer I was expecting, unless it was a room full of extremely highly technical people, or you happen to be in certain particular niches. Blockchain is still something that is not yet well known. Write this date down, August 18th, 2016, CEO Brain Trust meeting, Jack Shaw. That's the first time I heard of blockchain. That's what you'll be able to tell your grandchildren. Now, of course, it wasn't any one of these. It was a combination of all of these that enables this powerful innovation. So let's talk a little bit more about each of these emerging technologies and where they come into play. And oh, by the way, there are skeptics all over the place. And skeptics go back in history. Every time a new technology comes into place, 1876, the chief engineer of the British Post Office, the Americans have need of the telephone, but we don't. We have plenty of messenger boys. That's always been the case. And some of you, in fact, all of you, could say, well, Jack, this is very interesting, but we're not in the aircraft maintenance business. What's it got to do with us? It reminds me of a presentation I was doing at a technology marketing event back about 20 years ago, when I was describing this emerging technology called the World Wide Web and a new business practice called e-commerce. And I gave an example. I showed an example of going on. I went on and ordered one of my own books from this little startup website called Amazon.com. And afterwards, I actually had a guy raise his hand and say, Jack, this is all very interesting, but we're not in the book business. What's this got to do with us? Similarly, a couple of years later, I was speaking to a group of people, and I was painting a scenario, a near future scenario, that I said, at the time I described, I said, over the next 5 to 7 years, here's what we're going to be seeing. This guy came up to me afterwards, and he was clearly technically highly knowledgeable with respect to then currently widely used technologies like client-server computing. And he said, Jack, he said, I really like your enthusiasm about the future, but he said, there's some things about technology apparently you don't understand very well. He said, we just don't have the processing power or the bandwidth, certainly not the security. So this notion you're peddling that someday people are gonna be doing their banking electronically online, it'll never happen. Well, never say never.
Don't use some of it,
right? So, one of the things we talked about was augmented reality. What is augmented reality? Well, one part of augmented reality, as we were talking about over lunch, is the new Pokemon Go app that everybody's so excited about, and kids are walking into walls, and worse in some cases, and so forth. But it's actually been around for a while. Have you ever noticed, if you watch a football game on television, you see all these lines on the field, including the line of scrimmage and the first down line and all that. And if you're one of the rare few
who can actually still afford to go attend Major League pro football games in person. You get there, you look at the field and say, wait a minute, where's the first down line? How are we supposed to figure out where the line of scrimmage was? Because they aren't on the field. They're augmented reality. The reality of what the football field looks like is overlaid by digital information that augments that same capability. But augmented reality is already much more sophisticated than that. Here's an example.
Merlin embeds augmented reality into the existing Sandpiper pump identification and rebuild kit application. Scanning the QR code affixed to the pump initiates the 3D augmented reality experience. While pointing the mobile device directly at the pump, physical instructions are overlaid on top of it, bridging the gap between traditional 2D instructions and 3D physical objects. Merlin utilizes techniques such as diminished reality to occlude the virtually removed parts. In our next example, we'll demonstrate pump operation, where physical objects, such as the pump, can be masked to reveal a cutaway that illustrates operations, such as diaphragm contraction and expansion cycles, and how those cycles relate to the flow of liquid within the pump.
Now, augmented reality may not continue to improve. It may be a situation like Daryl Zanuck, film producer and co-founder of 20th Century Fox, who said in the late 40s, that television will never be able to hold on to any market it captures. After the first 6 months, people will soon get tired of staring at a plywood box every night. 3D printing is also on the verge of having huge changes in our world. Already, they have the ability to 3D print everything from the world's smallest lithium-ion battery, which you can see sitting on the tip of this pencil, to the 400-pound bioplastic cornerstones used to build this canal house in Amsterdam. GE, in fact, does already 3D print from titanium the jet fuel nozzles for its new latest version of its LEAP engines that are going to be being used in their Dreamliner and future aircraft. And by 3D printing it as a single piece, rather than 18 separate pieces that have to be welded together, there's no weakest link. They can also 3D print it with physical gaps where they aren't needed for structural strength, thereby making it lighter and running cooler, as well as five times as durable as its predecessor. Not only that, but at the University of Warwick in the UK, Dr. Simon Lee and his team have already figured out how to 3D print electrical circuitry directly into objects. Which means in the future, the Internet of Things will not require us to have to figure out how to attach storage, processing, and communications devices to physical objects. Those physical objects, however small, can be created, 3D printed, with the electronic circuitry, computing and communications circuitry built directly into them. Already they've 3D printed a bionic ear or a substrate on which human cells can grow with the circuitry for the cochlear implant already embedded within the bionic ear. Well, you might say though, wait a minute, let me see if I get this. 3D printing means that instead of companies that make and sell stuff, having them download the design and those 3D printing items being 3D printed either at 3D printing service bureaus or perhaps directly in individual companies or ultimately in individual homes. So what's to keep them from just printing as many copies as they want and selling it at the marginal cost of the material that is used, and how do we get compensated for the intellectual property value of our design in those products? Well, there's two parts to the answer to that question. The first part is, how do you know if there are multiple copies of what appears to be the same thing, and how do you tell them apart? Well, one way that could be used is through the use of quantum dots. What are quantum dots? Well, they're microscopically, nanoscopically small items that when you put billions of them together, you have an LED light. If you put just a few hundred into a 3D printed item, then that 3D printed item looks, feels, weighs, functions exactly as it would without them, except that when scanned by the right kind of light reader, will be able to uniquely identify the pattern of quantum dots in that particular item. So it's in effect like embedding a unique serial number in that particular item. This is somewhat analogous to the process that's used sometimes in scanning diamonds with lasers, where even if the diamond is exactly the same size, color, carats, weight, shape, cut, and so forth, as another diamond, it still has unique patterns in the way light moves through it and can be uniquely identified. The same process can be done for other items. So you would be able to detect if there were multiple and how many copies were made. Now we'll come back to some other things. I mentioned printing things at home, and of course a lot of experts have said, oh no, 3D printers will never be used at home. I heard that and I said, is there an echo around here? Where have I heard that before? Oh yes, 1979, when Ken Olson, the CEO of Digital Equipment, one of the hottest computer companies of the 1970s, said there is no reason for any individual to have a computer in his home. 15 years later, his company was acquired by a personal computer company, Compaq, later part of HP. Now, the Internet of Things is growing explosively. Best estimates currently are approximately 6 billion things communicate with the Internet. What kinds of things? Almost anything you can think of, from vehicles to pallets down to individual items. There tends to be a sort of minimal, right now, minimal size and cost that it makes sense to try to append Internet of Things computing and communications capabilities to, but even that's going to be going away over the next few years, or in many cases as 3D printing takes in and they can be embedded in them. Estimates are from various different companies. Gartner says by 2020, 26 billion things. Cisco says 50 billion. IDC says 212 billion. One way to look at that is, well, none of these people could possibly know what they're talking about, because those that ranges from a factor of 10 to 1. What it really means is simply no, they're all recognizing exponential growth rates, and all they're saying is to get to 212 billion. Cisco says, oh, it'll be 2021. Gartner says it'll be 2022 by the time they get there. Best estimates are by 2025, to somewhere between 2025 and 2030, we will see over a trillion physical objects communicating via the internet. Now, one of the kinds of things that will have a huge impact on our lives is wearable health sensors. It's a thing that can sense certain things about your body and about your activities, and then can communicate that information appropriately to things like your electronic medical records and to your doctors and so forth. And you can always tell when a new technology is on the brink of emerging broadly into the general awareness of the public when Dilbert talks about it. Oh, the health sensor you built into our smart watch prototype aren't working. According to your stupid sensors, my heart is going to stop beating, and maybe. Well, here's one of the things. You know, people have a tendency to look at things too much in isolation. Well, what is this Fitbit or whatever it might be really going to do for me? Yeah, there's an app I can look at certain stuff. Then you've got other people. Electronic medical records technologies have the potential to be one of the most world-changing for the good things we have. And yet, a lot of people who like things the way they worked in the old days and don't want to see anything in life or society change, oh, well, like electronic medical records, and it's government types forcing this down our throats. And what the stupidest idea I've ever heard in my whole life. You take highly paid, skilled professional doctors and turn them into data entry clerks. Who wants to do that? Well, you don't. And for the most part, doctors don't have to enter that information. It's captured digitally, and increasingly, it will be captured by sensors. And the notion of doctors entering information, other than perhaps voicing, literally speaking, their opinions about various alternatives, will be looked at 5 or 10 years from now as hopelessly antiquated. It's how all of these pieces fit together. And already with the data that's being able to be captured through millions of electronic medical records, they're making some interesting breakthrough discoveries. For example, using big data technologies, last year they were able to determine that there is a link between taking heartburn drugs and having heart attacks. Now, don't confuse causation and correlation. And so far nobody has suggested that there's a cause that taking heartburn drugs will make you have a heart attack. They don't understand what exactly the reason for the correlation is. But by looking at millions of medical records, they've been able to determine that there is in fact a correlation, which means there's something that can be studied. Maybe there's some common cause that is creating both of those things. But there's an opportunity for us to learn more about what we can do to prevent or reduce the number of heart attacks because of this data. Some will scoff, just like the FCC commissioner did in 1961 when he said, there is practically no chance that space satellites will be used to provide better telephone, telegraph, television, or radio service inside of the United States. I find it particularly interesting that in describing his attitude towards satellites, he thought it was important to cite the cutting edge technology of telegraphs, even in 1961. Now, intelligent agent technology is also going to have a huge impact on us. And what happens here, what we're talking about, is that as information is gathered from our business infrastructure, and the amount of information available to us is growing exponentially and will continue to as the Internet of Things continues to feed multiple orders of magnitude more data to us than we have the ability to process and understand yet. Big data technology will allow us to be able to process that information. Natural language processing will look at unstructured information that's available, whether it's from social media or other types of unstructured data, and that will provide input into intelligent agent technologies using tools like associative memory for pattern recognition and machine learning, so that these artificially intelligent agents can begin to replicate the kinds of thought processes that people who are experts in their fields go through. Now, we're never going to fully replace the functionality of subject matter experts, but if we get to the point where these can do 85 to 90% of what the subject matter experts can do, we have huge opportunities for increases in productivity of people. Furthermore, as they learn more, that feeds back in so that these systems continually get smarter over time. Already, IBM's Watson recently pinpointed that a patient in Japan who'd been treated for several months for leukemia and was not responding to the treatments, that the reason was that this patient had a rare form of leukemia different from the one that they were treating. How did Watson do it? It read 20 million case studies on leukemia treatments and identified that this patient had characteristics consistent with this particular rare form. Just what you would expect your oncologist to do today, right? Would you go back tonight and read 20 million case studies for me to see if you can that will help you figure out why this particular treatment isn't working as well as you hoped it might work?
I'll be back at 8 a.m.
I'll see you in the morning. So, in every field, everything from sales to customer support to product development, whatever you have in every organization, The best performance is typically done by a handful of experts. I mean, we're all familiar with this. It's the old 20-80 rule. The 20% of the best people produce 80% of the results. And the rest are just kind of there, you know, chugging along, trying to do better. Maybe they're new and they haven't developed the expertise and experience yet, what have you. Now, intelligent agent technologies that can improve human performance. They can leverage the knowledge of the experts to the rest of the organization, shifting that curve to the right so that the people who are not yet experts have an effective system coaching them to help them make better decisions and help them build their own expertise more quickly. And even the experts themselves can be assisted because they spend less time doing the low-level humdrum routine and data analytical kind of stuff and more time applying their years of judgment and experience and creativity to helping solve whatever problems it is that there are experts in addressing. Okay, what's the most powerful chess playing entity in the world? Is it the human world champion grandmaster? Or is it the most powerful chess playing software in the world?
Human chess master?
Oh, Garry Kasparov lost a Deep Blue 20 years ago. Well, it's a trick question because it's neither one. The best computer programs can now consistently beat the best grandmasters in the world. But a master of which there are only a few dozen grandmasters, but there are thousands of master chess players. A master chess player working with a PC-based average or slightly better than average computer program together can beat the best computer programs in the world that are working without a person and the best grandmasters in the world. The best chess players in the world are teams, collaborative, human and AI working together. Same thing starting to take place in manufacturing as we're seeing collaborative robotics. Robots by themselves can do certain things a lot better than people, but only to a certain extent. When people and robots work together as a team, they can provide performance that is superior to either one on its own. So what about these smart contracts that I refer to in the examples you looked at? Well, I asked you how many of you had heard of the blockchain, and most of you had not. But I'm going to guess that most of you have probably heard of Bitcoin. Bitcoin is the digital currency that has begun to receive some wide array of acceptance over the last few years. And the reason it has is that with Bitcoin, for the first time in 30 years of efforts to develop digital currencies, has been able to solve what's called the double spend problem. You know, if I have a piece of information and I want to put that out on the internet, you can make a copy of that same piece of information and share it with other people. It can go viral. Everybody can look at copies of stuff and have copies of information, or if I want to put out an image or a photograph or what have you that I'm willing to share, all that works great. But it doesn't work so great if we want to do that with money. You don't want me to give you $20 and then give you the same $20 and then give you the same $20. After a while, the $20 is worth nothing. So how do we keep assets that have value, whether it's money, intellectual property, artwork, deeds, what have you, safe? Well, the technology that underlies Bitcoin is what's called the blockchain. And I've been studying the blockchain for a number of years now. And over the past year, it's gotten a huge amount of interest. In fact, The Economist magazine published an article last fall describing the blockchain as the trust machine. And it said the blockchain was not only, to quote Mark Andreessen, inventor of the graphical web browser and co-founder of the Silicon Valley venture capital firm Andreessen Horowitz, the greatest thing to hit the internet since the World Wide Web. But according to The Economist, the blockchain is the most important advance in business record keeping since the invention of the double entry bookkeeping system over 500 years ago in Florence. Not surprisingly, it's received coverage in media all over the world, and it's beginning to be applied to record keeping in a wide array of activities. So what is a blockchain? Well, a somewhat technical definition of blockchain, but one I think we can break down pretty easily. It's a distributed public database that leverages cryptography and peer-to-peer technology to group data into blocks and store them in an immutable chain of transactions. Just to remind everybody exactly what we mean by immutable: unchanging over time, unable to be changed, fixed, set, rigid, inflexible, permanent, established, carved in stone, which is exactly what we want valid records to be. We don't want someone who may be authorized to access that data, but has objectives inconsistent with most of the people using it, or a hacker unauthorized to access that data to be able to get in and change records when they are valid. And one of the things you have is immutable record keeping with the blockchain. Now, how do these digital payments actually work? Well, we have two counterparties. A wants to pay B some money. Okay, so they identify who's counterparty A, who's counterparty B, how much money are they going to pay, when are they going to pay it, what currency is it going to be in, and all of that information, that transaction, is configured into a block. The transaction is broadcast across the entire network, which validates that block, and then it is added to the blockchain in such a way that it becomes part of the entire non-reversible history of transactions on that blockchain. And once it's successfully added to the blockchain, then counterparty B receives the funds that have been transferred that way. This entire process takes about 10 minutes on the average. Now compare that to international wire transfers today, which can take anywhere from 2 to 5 business days or more, even longer if you're using something like Western Union to try to move money around. So, to take a little bit closer look, it uses the same public and private key signature technology that underlies your ability to safely and securely purchase things on the internet right now. And it takes advantage of the fact that even organizations that don't have a reason to trust one another directly do have a common interest in having reliable information available for them to be able to access on the basis of which to determine how to make transactions and to make business decisions. Importantly, the blockchain is distributed. There are many replicas. It's not in a single central location like Target's or Home Depot's where somebody could hack into it and pick up all those millions of credit card numbers, because it's in thousands of locations around the world. And the database itself is a read-write-once database. In other words, anybody can access the information if they are authorized to see the information out there. And it takes authorization and cryptographically military grade security controls that they have to be able to pass in order to access only that information they're authorized to see. But anyone can see that information. But nobody can change information once it's been written. You can continue to append information to that. For example, if you agree that a transaction did not work out the way it was supposed to, you can append a reversing transaction that can, in effect, financially or economically undo the previous transaction. You can't go back in, though, and erase a transaction once it's recorded on the blockchain. Now, how many locations are we talking about? Currently, tens of thousands of locations. Not surprisingly, the locations tend to be centered geographically around those areas of the world which are where the highest economic activity is taking place. In years to come, we're likely to see this expand to millions of locations. And the total amount of computing power of these nodes on the blockchain is currently estimated to be somewhere between 10 and 100 times as much computing power as all of Google. Now, when we say that it can't be hacked, you would be quite correct if you were to say, well, there's nothing that can't be hacked. And in a narrow technical sense of the word, that's absolutely correct. Having said that, here's what you would need to do to hack the blockchain. First of all, you would have to get through the cryptographic security. And if you wanted to go in and change a record, and suppose that I had paid John $100, and then I wanted to change the record to show that I had paid John $200, and therefore that I was entitled to some product or service or what have you that I wasn't really entitled to, I can't just go into that particular record and change the $100 to $200, because now the entire blockchain, which is all linked together, is invalid. I have to change the entire blockchain with millions of entries on it. Right now it's 65 gigabits, okay? And I would have to rewrite every record in that blockchain all the way back to the very first entries ever posted. The first entry on the Bitcoin blockchain was posted in early January of 2009. And I would have to do that not only at one node, I would have to do that at every one of those thousands of nodes all over the world. And I would have to do that at all of those nodes within the same roughly 10-minute time frame that it takes to update those nodes with new information. It's been estimated that hacking all of those nodes simultaneously within that time period, for that time period, would take approximately the same amount of energy output to run the computing power required to do that as would be given off in the same period of time by the sun.
So if you got an extra sun, then
you don't. So yeah, right. Otherwise, it may not be economically feasible to do this. So already we've seen national governments put their fiat currencies on the blockchain. Tunisia did at the end of last year. Estonia already has. Several others are in the process of putting their currencies on the blockchain. But it doesn't have to just be used for money. It could be used for things like car titles, home deeds, any other assets. Why not 3D printing blueprints? And in fact, it could be used for that too. Now, smart contracts are contracts that in effect are broken down, all the Boolean logic of the contract. If this happens, that will happen. If this doesn't happen, that this will happen and that won't happen, and who the counterparties are and all the ifs and thens and terms and conditions and consequences and so forth can all be specified electronically. But the difference is when it's put on the blockchain, it's not only a digital record of all the terms and conditions of the contract, but the contract itself can be an active computer program. So it can take transactions and other event information that comes in and act on that. So when you set up a contract, for example, to buy something, you can load into escrow on the contract that particular amount of currency at the same time, and when that transaction is completed, such as when the device is successfully installed on the aircraft, then it's released from escrow and the funds flow to the provider, the seller of the device in this particular case. Or if for some reason the transaction is not successfully completed, then that's identified as such, and the escrow funds are returned back to who would otherwise have been the payer. So smart contracts can be proactive entities operating on behalf of the two or multiple contractual entities that are involved. And there's already software out there that is beginning to facilitate the process of helping people to set up these smart contracts. Now, by being able to put smart contracts with appropriate front-end user faces and so forth to make them easy to use on the internet, we're beginning to see a move toward more decentralized capabilities. One example of that, well, we've heard of what's the last few years of what's being referred to as the sharing economy, Uber, Airbnb, and so forth. Well, folks, this is not really the sharing economy. There's no sharing about it. Uber is not sharing any of its profitability from $65 billion or whatever it is a year of bookings that they're doing. What they are is they're a service aggregator. They've aggregated millions of people willing to offer the service of driving people around, or in the case of Airbnb, letting out rooms, and provided a good way for people who want those services to be able to find them and buy them. And more power to them, they've done very well. But in a decentralized model, you could have a contract functioning out there, a smart contract sitting on the blockchain, accessible by people who are interested in providing the service, who can specify what's the pricing terms, where I live, where I'm willing to drive, what times of day, what kind of vehicle do I have, and so forth, making that information available, and then allow people who want to take advantage of a transportation service like this to be able to say, here's where I need to go from point A to point B at this point in time, and have the system, the smart contract, then provide them with an array of choices of different types of vehicles, pricing, timing, and so forth. They can then pick the one that best met their particular set of needs, and the entire transaction could be done without any third-party intermediary being required. Now, obviously, there'd have to be some initial implementation process and some very small cost involved in it, but we'd be talking about taking 20%, like we're talking about taking 1% or less off the top of the cost. More cost effective for the users of it, at the same time that it's more profitable for the providers of the service. And this same type of thing is being applied in dozens of different ways. I realize this is an eye test, but any of you, if you'll give me a card or drop me a note afterwards, I'll be glad to send you a copy of these slides and you can look at it closely. But everything from the Internet of Things capabilities to digitizing assets, proof of ownership, identification, points of value transfer, online storage, I mean, literally hundreds of applications in dozens of different fields of industries are already being used, developed for blockchain technology. So conceptually, what the blockchain is a new form of information technology, a globally distributed, always-on database that contains a ledger for secure, permanently recorded, independently validated transactions. And as such, it can act as a registry for assets, keeping inventories, tracking those assets, and exchanging those assets, whether they are purely digital assets, like digital currencies, intellectual property, deeds, titles, that sort of thing, art, music, what have you, or whether they are physical assets that are represented uniquely by digital tokens that are maintained. And what this means is you've got a system, management system for all of the world's assets, smart property, and itemizable things. And it can be used as a public records repository, a digital representative and participatory legal and governance system. So one of the types of valuable, unique assets that can be tracked, and in fact in Estonia is already being tracked on the blockchain, is your right to cast one and one only vote. And you'd have the ability then to be able to have a digital records of all the votes that were cast with the security in place to be able to ensure that no one will be able to tell who cast which votes, and yet absolute security of that the election hasn't been rigged. Mm-hmm. All right, so do you need a blockchain in your business? Well, one very simple algorithm that I saw recently looks like this. Do I need a blockchain? No. Well, it's intended as a joke, but there's a reality in this sense. How many people here have at home own a power drill? Let me see your hands if you own a power drill. Okay, you know, the interesting thing about it is not one of you needs a power drill. What you need are holes. You just bought power drills because you came to the conclusion that that particular technology was the best, easiest, and most cost-effective for producing holes. Same thing with the blockchain. It's an enabling technology. You don't have to use the blockchain, but what you want are things you can do with the blockchain, and that you probably wouldn't be able to do without it. So here's a little more useful particular algorithm that talks about such things as, do you need a database? Does it require shared write access by writing to it, adding or updating it, as the case might be? Are writers known and trusted? Are their interests unified? You want or use need to use a trusted third party. All of those will help you figure out if you need to use a blockchain. Then there are different kinds of blockchains and types, and it's beyond our scope today to get into all of that, but other questions that help you determine which approach to blockchain technology is going to be best for you. The World Economic Forum did a survey last year looking at tipping points for new technologies and business practices, and one of their questions was, when do you think 10% of global gross domestic product will be stored on blockchain technology? The answer averaged out to 2027, but 58% of the respondents expected the tipping point to have occurred by 2025. I am among that 58%. I believe it will be somewhere between 2020 and 25 that we get to the point where 10% of the value of the transactions in the world are done on the blockchain, and then it will just continue to accelerate from there. The positive impacts, though, are tremendous. Increased financial inclusion. 2.5 billion people in the world do not have bank accounts, primarily because they do not have any way to prove their identity, because they were born in places where birth certificates, if used at all, are rarely produced at birth. They may have been born at home instead of at a hospital or a medical facility, and therefore they don't get to do things like borrow money to buy houses, cars, or start businesses. Think what will happen when everybody in the world has the option, or nearly everybody in the world has the option, instead of only about 70% of us, to participate in the economy. Same thing, better property records, especially in emerging markets. It's estimated that 70% of the property owned in the world has questionable title. If you live in some third world country with a dictator in charge of things who suddenly decides that your piece of property is exactly where his best buddy and biggest campaign contributor would like to build their beach house, he'll just make arrangements to have the records changed and say, well, I'm sorry, it says here in our government records that you don't own this property, that my buddy owns this property. Get out of here. Not with a blockchain, you won't be able to change those records like that. In fact, that's already been happening in Honduras. A company called Factum is working with the government of Honduras, because the last dictator of Honduras got kicked out and blood was due for pretty much that exact reason. Increased transparency, one of the great potential societal benefits of blockchain technology. Not surprisingly, almost $1 billion has been invested in blockchain technology in the period of 2013 to 2015. Those numbers are continuing to increase, and there's startups in every area, from cloud storage to smart contracts, social networking, digital identity, Internet of Things, even anti-counterfeiting. I had a chance to talk with a lady who heads up a company called Everledger, which tracks diamonds on the blockchain from the time those diamonds are mined until they land in the hands of the owner. So you can verify that a diamond is not a blood diamond or a conflict diamond from an area where it's supporting terrorists or thug governments in parts of the world. One perspective on the blockchain that I think is a very good one from Melanie Swan is that blockchain technologies, cryptocurrencies, and smart contracts are truly a new kind of thing. Technically, conceptually, structurally, and socially, with tremendous potential to decentralize and transform the manner in which we conduct all activity to realize futures that are more efficient and participative, scalable at a planetary level, and enhancing of core values such as liberty, equality, and innovation. Now, blockchain technology's got tremendous potential for us. But again, it's still part of a bigger picture. What we're gonna see emerging, in my opinion, over the next few years are global autonomous supply chains where not only processes and enterprises, but across enterprises, products, services, parts, materials, information, and funds flow automatically without any unnecessary human intervention in the process, but all according to goals, objectives, terms, and conditions laid out by the entities, organizations, companies, people involved in these processes, and allowing for human intervention wherever it's required to solve problems or manage exceptions. In fact, I believe we're going to see a move toward the autonomic enterprise. Remember high school biology class? The autonomic nervous system manages all the subconscious functions of your body, so you don't have to spend all your time thinking about remembering to breathe. And don't forget to beat your heart about once a second or so. And how are you doing on digesting lunch? You can focus your brain power on higher order issues while the autonomic nervous system runs the routine. And I believe the autonomic nervous, enterprise of the future will function in much the same way. People aren't going away. but they will be freed up from the low-level routine activities to focus on strategic goals and objectives. Even on a broader ecosystem, business ecosystem perspective, we're going to see much the same thing. Business ecosystems are made up of many different levels, functions, processes, roles, rules, relationships, workflows, all kinds of interactions and cycles take place. That happens right now. But it's painfully slow to pull new players into the ecosystem, find them and engage with them, and document and contract with them. And I believe that what we're going to be seeing in the future are self-configuring business ecosystems, where intelligent agent technology will be able to use platforms that are a futuristic combination of what we now think of as Amazon.com, LinkedIn, Google, and even Match.com, to help them find partners, not romantic partners in this particular case, but business partners, people who have products and services to offer, or conversely, people who can take advantage of products and services that you have to offer, digitally, continually searching for one another, fluctuating in availability and pricing as the global markets of supply and demand expand and contract in real time. One of my favorite quotes from Bill Gates: so you always overestimate the change that will take place in the next 2 years and underestimate the changes that will occur in the next 10. Don't let yourself be lulled into inaction. Just because you might not see as much change as you expect in the next 60 or 90 or 180 days, over the next 5 to 10 years, our world will change more than it has in the last 50. And it's going to make the changes that we saw with the Internet and World Wide Web from the late 90s to date look like just this minor bump in the road. So how do you plan for this? Well, to do this, you need to go through the process of digital transformation. Digital transformation is not about force-fitting new technologies into your business. It's about rethinking the entire business model and ecosystem, and then using any and all technologies needed to implement the new vision. One of the best tools that I've seen, approaches that I've seen to doing this, is what's called third horizon planning. Third horizon planning works like this. First of all, first horizon planning is all about today's core business, but it includes the planning for enhancements to and extensions of that core business, operational efficiencies, near-term process improvements. It's the type of thing we all go through in our businesses every year. Third horizon planning, though, is the long-term vision. What could your organization look like as a digital enterprise functioning within a digital ecosystem? It parallels first horizon planning, but without today's constraints. That means you have to look in the future 2 to 5 years or even more for very large enterprises. But by doing so, you have a time cushion so that the systems, processes, assets, and infrastructure can be changed as needed to implement that vision. And then you rethink your business models and processes in terms of what could be enabled by emerging technologies. What are the possible futures in your business, in your area of core competency? And you identify those scenarios. Then that's where the second horizon planning comes in. You identify the most promising third horizon opportunities, and you divert some resources from the current core first horizon activities to that those intermediate term second horizon initiatives. Now, we've seen these kinds of things referred to as skunk works and by other terms such as that over the years. And one of the challenges is people will say, well, let's do a test or set up a group to start trying this new approach, this new technology, whatever. And it often doesn't work out. Part of the reason is it's not being done with a broader strategic long-term view in mind. It's being done simply, let's see if we'll test this one thing and suddenly discover something wonderful. It's unlikely to deliver significant benefits unless it's consistent with a third horizon long-term strategy. Now, like any given strategy, it's going to evolve over time. So if you develop a third horizon strategy that's looking out 5 years from now, by the time you get to 3 years from now, first of all, where you're going to be anticipating to be 2 years after that, 5 years from the original planning date, is going to be different. And certainly where you're looking out 5 years from that point is going to be different. But it's not going to be so radically different that you can't shift your plans and directions to account for it. So it's a rolling forward process that needs to be done. So to summarize that very briefly, and we could spend the whole day just walking through the details of doing the digital transformation planning process, but at a high level, it's planned and executed in three parts: a long-term vision of the digital enterprise that you develop in third horizon planning, continuing to evolve your core operations, especially those that you anticipate being retained, even in maybe very different form within your long-term vision. But you probably don't want to invest a huge amount of money, time, effort, resources into refining and improving those aspects of your current business operations that your five-year plan says are no longer going to exist in that digital environment of the future. That doesn't mean you don't put out some fires, you don't solve a few short-term problems until you are able to transition it out. It just helps you to establish your priorities. And the second-term planning is about the components, developing and testing the components of the digital enterprise that you will need to have in place to implement that vision 5 or more years out, but that are not yet part of your current core operations, so that over time they meld in with those core operations as you evolve toward your long-term vision. And at that point, we've covered a lot of ground today. Let me open it up for questions.
So you said blockchain, you've got these immutable transactions. So I buy something from Robin, and it's recorded in a block.
Correct.
Now, Robin says she was never paid. What is then the recourse to blockchain? Is there
part of what would be recorded in the block is not only that you bought the item and you paid money, but that Robin received the money. Mm-hmm. All of that information would be recorded in the block. So if Robin said, I never got paid by Stuart,
yeah.
Okay. We just go back and we look at the relevant blockchain transactions. It shows right here you were paid, and here's how you were paid, and how and where the funds were transferred, and the exact time in which it was there. So that transparency would be there. Now, only those people authorized to see that information, which would presumably include you, Robin, and any third-party entity that you might want to be invoking for resolving that claim, you know,
so
would be authorized to see that.
Do those parties exist yet? Like, is that governmental? Is it legal?
Well, it's gonna, yeah, it's gonna, yes and no. The parties, for the most part, exist. We're certainly not in the next 5 or even 10 years gonna see drastic changes to our governmental and legal systems in terms of overall structure. We may see some fairly drastic changes in some third world countries. But, you know, in the United States, Western Europe, other major economic countries, but what we will begin to see are adoption of those. Now, those legal and governance kinds of issues are ones that will have to be resolved. I mean, many of you remember, I think I see enough gray hairs here, that people that will remember back in the 80s when your attorney would say, it's perfectly fine for you to go ahead and send draft copies of the contracts back and forth via your fax machines, but when you get ready to execute it, it has to be wet ink on a piece of paper that is folded up and stuck in an envelope and delivered by the mail. Well, we've long since eliminated, with rare exceptions, the need. You know, people understand that a facsimile or a scan of a signature is just as valid legally in every court of the land as a original document would be. But it took a few years to get past that hang-up. Laws and regulations don't keep up with technology. But because technology is ultimately driven by economics and the other way around, the same kinds of pressures will be there to allow the systems to react.
Just to add a little bit more to that, it's a challenge that I face in securing an automobile. I want to make sure that I know who you are. Even though you have a photo ID issued by a state government, you can buy an entire immigration package in San Diego that includes a social security card, an INS form that says you're valid to be in this country, a driver's license for $25. Not very good security when it comes down to it. So we will be taking a picture of that ID, but we're also going to go to third-party sources to validate additional information that only you as the individual would know. Once we have got that surety, then we will say the contract is complete. Now, I can do that legally without all of that, but the reality is for a $25,000 purchase, that money's paid to the dealer. If that car disappears, my company, directly or indirectly, is on the hook for it, even though we aren't putting up the money, third parties are putting up the money. So we are embedding additional layers of security in there to know exactly who we're dealing with. Now, as far as government access and regulatory access to that is concerned, the industry is slowly but surely reaching a consensus. Quite often you'll hear some real heavy bickering when it comes down to it, but transparency is king. And they are building modules that allow transparent access, again, limited to the relevant people, limited to the banking commissioner for things directly to do with banking, the SEC, etc. But they are being proactive about providing that to essentially speed up the cycle of adoption. Because even Wall Street is based on technology that was designed and first implemented in the 70s. It's got 15 different layers of technology that allows you to now do things in microseconds. But the actual settlement is still done on IBM 370 computer equivalents.
It can take days.
It can take days. It's
really crazy. One of the things that Edwin brought along is this is the bit smart mini computer, excuse me, Mini Cooper.
Good slip.
Freudian slip. Bit smart mini with the actual Internet of Things tracking device built into it. Now, I understand that the one that he uses in the cars is not exactly the same size with respect to the automobile as this one is here. In fact, I assume it is actually this size, right?
It's that size, and that's 1/24th scale.
Okay, so it's a 1/24th smaller than that. But what this then allows to do is for the tracking of an automobile. So in the occasional case where it would be necessary to find and retrieve the automobile because payments haven't been made, it would be that much easier to try to track it down. And I must give this back to Edwin before I lose track of it. But there's a good example of, in order to solve the problem of adding the ability to have a decentralized or somewhat more decentralized lending capability in the automotive financing marketplace, that they are adding a combination of Internet of Things technologies and blockchain technologies, as well as other already well-established technologies, to try to develop this model of a new digital ecosystem.
John, what's your perspective on how Bitcoin got its value outside of the data aspect of it?
Repeat the question,
yes.
So we can get it.
How do you build a current? This has always been a puzzle here, and the only thing I've got my own conclusion, but I'm curious. How did the Bitcoin establish a monetary value outside of the data itself?
Right. How did the Bitcoin establish a monetary value outside of the data itself? Okay. Couple things by background. One, in order to create a Bitcoin, if you will, you have to go through a process called mining. And that means you have to solve some very complex cryptographic algorithmic problems. It takes a great deal of computing power. At first, it could be done relatively quickly and easily, but the way the algorithms are structured, as more and more bitcoins have been mined, it becomes increasingly difficult and requires more power to create it. It is set up so that there will be a maximum of 21 million bitcoins ever. And it is estimated that although I think it's, and Edwin, correct me if you know differently, I think we're somewhere around in the teens of millions of bitcoins.
We're about 13.7
million bitcoins currently, market value of approximately $10 billion currently. So we've mined about two-thirds of the bitcoins. It's estimated, though, that at the decreasing rate at which that will take place, it will take till approximately the year 2140 to mine the last of the 21 million Bitcoin. So you have a control on the scarcity of Bitcoin, and you have resources required to create them. And it's After that, it's only on the demand side as people see the value of utilizing it. The very first transaction that I'm aware of, other than some transactions of paying miners to create Bitcoin, was a transaction for somebody within the first few days. They bought a pizza and paid like 5,000 Bitcoins for a pizza. Because at that time, a Bitcoin was worth a tenth of a cent, or however the math works out.
Right.
Now that Bitcoin is worth $700 approximately, and whoever paid 5,000 Bitcoins for that pizza is probably wishing, hoping that was the best darn pizza he ever had in his life.
Yeah.
But he would have had to hold on to it for 7 years through ups and downs and so forth. It is becoming a more stable investment as it becomes more established. And in fact, I've seen a number of people, because it tends to be not highly correlated with other financial investments, that it is a flight to security somewhat. And in fact, on the day of Brexit, when the British pound went like this and gold went like that, so did Bitcoin. Bitcoin went way up right after Brexit, because people said, I don't know what the pound's going to do, but the Bitcoin's going to go up. And it is still a variable. In other words, you don't want to take all your retirement savings and plunge it into Bitcoin. But as part of a portfolio, toward the more speculative end of a portfolio, it's something that makes good sense. And it's something I'd love to get your thoughts on later.
Yeah.
Because well, not only John, but also Joe. Yeah, because I've seen presentations by investment advisors that have basically said, here's where Bitcoin should fit in an overall portfolio of investment. As opposed to 4 or 5 years ago, all you would have said was, it doesn't fit in that at all. It fits in next to, do I want to go blow a bunch of money at the track and hope I get lucky and play the slots in Las Vegas? But not anymore, so it's starting to change.
And as that stability of Bitcoin is entering into the market, there's new entrants in the international money transfer. One of them is called Abra. If you go to their website, abra.com, they make zero reference to blockchain technology, Bitcoin, anything. What they're doing behind the scenes, and they're set up specifically for people to transfer money in Western economies into Africa, where the vast majority of people don't have banks. However, the vast majority of at least 15 years and older do have phones. So they set it up so that it will be transmitted to Nigeria, confirmed, and then that money will be posted on their phone in the local currency or using M-Pesa, which is a local company in Africa that gives value to this. The cost of doing it is the equivalent of less than 1.5%. The equivalent transaction, or Abra, that can take 2 days, and that's basically that last mile of physically getting onto the phone, is very dependent on the in-country situation. And in some cases, people want to get the cash, so they send it to an individual. That individual takes the cash and gives it physically to them. Western Union will do the same service. It will charge anywhere from 12 to 18%. It will take, as you mentioned earlier, anywhere from 5 to 7 days. And there is still in-world breakpoints where people will steal the money. So not all of the money ends up getting to the final recipient, even though Western Union will guarantee you that it gets there.
They're guaranteeing it gets to the Western Union office where you can go in and pick it up with the right ID.
Mm-hmm.
They're not guaranteeing that the guys hanging around outside the Western Union office waiting for people to pick up their cash aren't going to relieve you of it as soon as you get out the door.
Yeah. And then what Abra does is they take the US dollar, they convert it immediately into Bitcoin, and because they're typically only holding it in Bitcoin for 3 days, their exchange rate risk is relatively low. There is hedging in Bitcoin. So they actually take a short-term 3-day hedging contract just in case it goes from 500 to 700 in 3 days, which has happened. Or 700 to 500, which would be even worse for them. They hedge everything immediately. But even with that extra overhead, they are able to make a profit very quickly and easily.
Tom, you had a question?
Brian, you go ahead first.
Yeah. Jack, how will the artificial intelligence impact programmers in the future? People that do coding, will that be?
Well, for 50 years, the level of coding has risen, right, raised, in the sense of people don't write code in machine language anymore in zeros and ones. They don't write it in the operating systems. I mean, yes, there are people who create new operating systems. But for the most part, most code for most applications is now written at a very high level. And that's going to continue to improve. People still have to be able to design programs to work effectively. Mm-hmm. So for example, one of the challenges that Edwin is facing is the people who can code in blockchain are rare and very expensive resources right now. However, there's already software being developed that handles all of the blockchain interface stuff, so the traditional Java programmers who cost about a third as much, even though they're well-paid people, can work with those tools and be able to use them. Now, that's not a direct answer to your question, but AI, it's hard to project what might happen a generation from now, 25 or 30 years from now. Over the next 5 or 10 years, AI is not going to make software programming go away.
Okay.
In fact, it's going to mean there's going to be a demand for more people who understand how to code systems that use AI technologies, that take advantage of tools like machine learning and pattern recognition technology, natural language programming, Bayesian belief networks, situational assessment, partial order least commitment planning, and a host of other kinds of AI technologies that are out there. How to design those systems, and then how to interact with the relevant software in order to build and implement those systems. So I see one area where there will absolutely continue to be an increase in demand will be for IT, programmers and technicians. They'll just have different skill sets than today, just as the ones today have different skill sets
language
than 15 or 20 years ago.
Thank you.
So I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I would actually go one step beyond that and say, it's definitely going to be different languages, but they will also, especially the ones that end up being paid a lot more, they will be the people who understand the business that they're developing the application for more clearly than they do now. A good quality IT developer understands how to program in Java and can sit there and generate whatever very quickly. However, they're not very skilled in the environment that they're in as far as the business. If they're in a janitorial service company, for example, they don't understand what it takes to put a person in that building for that specific time slot to make sure that it's ready for the next day. The people who will become the premier stars will be more focused on what am I actually implementing this for than how am I actually doing it. And that's the more of that is going to occur over the next 5-10 years.
So just to take off on that question, my son is realizing that his technology job at the television station is probably going to get replaced through artificial intelligence, and he's thinking about going back to school and just getting some basic programming skills, like learning how to program a phone. Do you think he's going to have to get a lot more training than that to make a career out of coding?
Anybody who's going to work in IT as a profession, especially if they're going to be a coder, is going to have to be continuously retrained for the rest of their life.
Yeah.
They'll have to spend 20% of their time learning new skills, new approaches, new tools and technologies, and at least 20% of the time, and then the other 80% or less actually then implementing and working with those tools.
Right. That's
the notion that somebody would go to school, learn how to program, and then go out and spend the next 30 or 40 years doing that programming has not been valid for at least a decade, maybe 15 or 20
right.
years.
My other question was, we've got a couple of industries in the room that I think are going to be severely disrupted, education being one of them, John. It's almost obvious that brick and mortar universities are going to die, or at least be, something's going to happen.
Revamped.
Yeah, and that's going to totally change your business. Maybe in 15, 20 years you won't have much of a marketplace. I don't know. What are you thinking?
Well, student health is kind of where we first become aware of our healthcare, isn't it?
So am I really last to market or first?
Yeah.
And you, who holds the data?
Mm-hmm. I think the reality of Amazon.com and the reason it is so successful, it's selling, what, 100 billion? Roughly like that. The reason that Walmart just bought Jet, a 1.5-year-old company, for $3 billion, yeah, is that they only have 15 billion in online sales. And they have put, if you look at the actual technology implementation costs, they put twice the amount of dollars, technical dollars, into creating that same amount of market share. So they are well behind the curve. They realize that they're going to be driven out of business if they don't do something.
So it's certainly looking beyond the brick and mortar.
Yes.
You have to.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we are doing that. In effect, if you move universities beyond brick and mortar to, you know, the MOOCs, as they call them, multi-organizational, or, you know,
massive courses, yeah,
is that in effect the students become sort of a giant affinity group to which you can still then offer healthcare services or options that are available, as long as you can deal with the geographic decentralization that is likely to take place. So it's going to be an interesting challenge, and I think each of us has to look through our business, think about our business, and, you know, think about where might we be. Come up with the wildest thing that you can imagine for 5 years from now. Reality is probably going to be wilder, but at the very least, you have covered some bases and thought about some considerations of, well, if this were to happen and that were to happen, then it's possible we can see an outcome that looks like this. How would we work? How would we leverage the skills and expertise and core competencies we've developed over 2 or 5 or 15 or 50 years as a company to be able to serve the needs of a particular market in this radically different environment of the near future, 5 to 10 years from now? And have several of those scenarios in mind. And what are we gonna track to see? Which levers do we need to push and pull? How do we need to implement the evolution of our organization so that we can be flexible? At the same time we're moving forward, we have several different options in mind as where we go. The notion that we're gonna set down a 5-year plan and 3 years from now we're gonna be saying, no, we're not doing that, because back in 2016 we wrote the 5-year plan and it didn't say anything about doing that in 2019. Well, no, that's the death knell. It's gonna be exactly the opposite of that. That doesn't mean being frenetic and responding to everything in the short term. You've got to have a long-term view and goal in mind, even if over time that long-term goal itself evolves. Yes, Ned.
With the potential of AI coming, in line with Tom's question about his son, I've got some young kids. What would be the most AI-resistant feat for them to be trained in? You had a child who was 10 years old now, looking at where technology has gone in the last 10 or 20 years, and it's going to multiply in the next 10 years. Where would you tell your son or daughter to focus on to be, have a career that was resistant?
Well, I was going to use a slightly different example, but in your case, I think one that's very appropriate is hair care, mm-hmm, or massage, or anything that requires a high level of intimate, and I don't mean that necessarily in the physical sense, but close personal interaction and knowledge of the individuals that you are interacting with in terms of delivering a service of some kind. It's very, very difficult for me to picture 50 years from now people will have robots giving them massages or doing their hair.
I had to smile on that because I have a massage chair at the office that the employee uses.
Well, all right. Now, that's a good point, the massage chair. But it's still not quite the same experience as the hands-on experience.
But combined together.
That could be. That was your name.
That's right. Maybe the massage table becomes an active massage table while the masseuse or masseur is doing their thing on the flip side. But so I think, you know, some of those kinds of things, I think there's a high level of kind of strategic planning, strategic thinking, and some of the educational stuff, I think, but not the educational stuff that says, all right, let's talk about, you know, the 100 years war and the participants in this. The educational stuff about what do you need to learn, and it's almost more sort of educational coaching, if you will. What do you need to learn if this is the area of interest that you have? You know, I do think that 50 or 100 years from now, people will be working half as much and have three times as much leisure time as we have. And I think that's a long-term trend we have seen for centuries, you know. If you'd gone back 150 years, at a time when, in the United States at least, 70% of the population spent average of 10 to 12 working hours, 6 days a week, just raising the food it took to feed 100% of the population. And if you'd gone to any of the economists at the time, or business or governmental leaders at the time, and said, you know what, 100 years from now, in other words, I'm saying 50 years ago, all the food for our society would be produced that will only require 2% of the people. They would have said, oh my gosh, that'll be an economic disaster. We're going to have 68% of our population unemployed. Because they hadn't even, wouldn't have been able to envision even the industrial age, much less the electrical age, and the communications age, and the internet age, and the blockchain age, that's all coming. So I think that long term, life is going to be, there are very, very few people who really understand what life is really like for the vast majority of the population. 100 or 150 years ago, we said, yeah, that's something I would like to go back to compared to the way I live today. And I think the same thing will be happening going forward. In the meantime, there still are great dislocations that can happen, especially by people who are caught unprepared. So I think education, on a personal perspective, I think it's up to society as a whole. And one of the most effective ways society can accomplish things is through our governmental organizations at local, state, national, and global levels, in terms of educating people, providing for transition capabilities. So to take people, now if somebody is unwilling to work to learn new skills, there's not much you can do. They're 85 years old, it probably doesn't make that much difference. Keep feeding them, you know, make sure that there's some kind of safety net so that their physical stuff is, they're secure and safe and eat and get reasonable health care, and aside from that, they may have past their point. But if they're 45 years old and say, I know I've got another 20 or 30 years in the workforce, but I just want to keep driving my truck, when all the studies show that, yeah, you know, in another 20 years, most trucks will be driving themselves, and you won't have a job driving a truck, well, I'm sorry, that's what I want to do, that's the only thing I want to learn. Well, that person has got a problem, and his reality is going to slap him in the face. But for the vast majority of people, once they truly understand that, once it's effectively communicated to them, we're willing to say, okay, I can learn a new skill, what do I need to learn to do? There are a broad array of new skills that can be learned. And a lot of them have to do, maybe you're the person, if you're really into trucks, maybe you're the person who maintains the self-driving functionality of trucks, and you learn the computer, pardon?
Technician roles.
The technician roles, yeah. You learn the computer skills and the maintenance and mechanic skills and what have you to be able to do and keep self-driving trucks working right. Not that you would necessarily have to stay in the same field. You learn, decide, well, I've always been interested in something else. Let me learn another set of skills that's got a better role for the future. So there's going to be a host of those. And you know, if I was a smart enough person to be able to tell you exactly how to plan for every step in detail in the future, I would have done that 20 years ago, and I wouldn't be standing in front of you by now. I'd be lying on the beach somewhere. But I think in terms of general trends and directions, that, you know, those are some of the opportunities. Let me finally say, you've got my contact information here. Please feel free, give me a call, drop me an email.
Well, that's what I was gonna ask. Like, you know, you're talking for a company's vision 5 years, 10 years. Is that where you help, you come in, and not necessarily from a strategic business
point of view, or maybe that is part of it, but from a technology point of view, is that what you're helping people?
It's a combination. When I consult with organizations that use technology as a tool to help them manage their businesses more effectively, as distinct from technology solution providers, although the line is getting increasingly blurred. But when I do that, most of you fall into that category. Yeah, what I do is it's a combination of doing initially education and then strategic planning, in the sense of not helping you figure out what business you're in, because if you need help figuring that out, there are people who are specialists in that, or what you should be in. But yeah, it's at the verge of what you should be in and what the implications of emerging technologies, working through and facilitating processes and developing plans, develop that third horizon plan, you know, learn enough about your business, your ecosystem, your participants, draw in all these emerging, I mean, there are many other emerging technologies we didn't have. One of you asked me about drones before, for example, robotics, and I mean, there's a host of other things like that. But I did try to touch on some of the ones I thought were most important here. And yeah, those are some of the kinds of things I do. And a lot of what I do is speaking at events like this, trade association conferences, with technology companies. I speak a lot at marketing events and user group conferences and that kind of thing. I also consult with technology companies on their strategic direction. What kinds of products and services could they be offering to anticipate the near-term emerging needs of the market? And how do they educate their target markets so that they can understand the value that those solutions can have in addressing their needs?
Okay. Even as a new startup, I can see a role for Jack's knowledge and inspiration, because just in today's talk, I've realized there's a couple of things that within 2 or 3 years, like this, I have to physically provide right now. But if it could be painted onto the car, gee whiz, that saves me a major problem, and it also reduces, this costs me $125 per car to install. Once it's installed, it's there forever unless something happens today. But if I could have that painted on for $10, that increases my penetration ability probably 200-300-fold.
Right.
So it's, and I also realize, even though I'm disintermediating quite a lot of different groups, I too can be disintermediated. So I want to make sure that I'm ahead of the curve where possible. I don't want to have somebody else eat my lunch.
Yeah. Other questions, comments?
I have one more question. I think artificial intelligence is gonna be one of the big game changers, obviously. Another person in the room is a lawyer, and I was reading an article recently where they were talking about how you can get legal advice on about 50% of what's going on, what they need advice for, with 80% accuracy versus less than 80% accuracy from a live lawyer, and they can get it through artificial intelligence. So the article was saying, if you're thinking about going to law school, don't go, because you're not going to have a big
future. I saw the same thing.
Huh?
I saw the same thing. It actually said 90% of legal assistants and paralegals would lose their jobs, and I think it was 16% of attorneys by the year, I mean, and with like 10 years or something. It's crazy.
I think that's a good point. I would just amend that slightly to say, if you're going to be a lawyer, in addition to studying law, study advanced IT systems such as AI-enabled capabilities, so that you understand how to use these tools as effectively as possible. And the study that you're talking about, I saw the same one, and basically they took some of the people who were very top lawyers in their field in the whole country and acknowledged as such, because these were the judges. And then they went out to a bunch of people that were basically routine local practitioners and in a given legal field, gave them these tests, and then they had an AI legal system take the same test, and the AI legal system got it right 80% of the time, and I think that the local practitioners got it right, was it 50% of the time, 70? It was well less than 80% of the time, so the AI system is better. Now obviously, who gets it right 100% of the time? Well, presumably that small number of judges that are regarded as the top leaders in the field, because after all, who else decides what's the right and wrong answer? I suppose ultimately judges in court, I suppose, but, and even that changes over time. But the point being that it's those people at the top that will never go away. I mean, it'll be different people occupying those roles. There'll always be a need for people to understand the law well enough and the way to apply it well enough, as opposed to somebody who simply at a point in time learns a set of stuff and then never learns anything more, just like the doctor who came out of medical school in 1932 and was the sharpest young guy on the block, but, you know, 50 years later was still practicing medicine the same way. And when I was growing up, there were doctors like that. There aren't doctors like that anymore. You have to keep going back to school and relearning new skills. I think the same things can apply in every profession, even technology futurists.
So I think we need to coach our kids to be ready to do their homework for a lifetime.
That's the challenge. You yeah, have that's why I asked the question. I've seen two other studies like that. One dealt with experts making decisions versus formula algorithms. And the formula algorithms beat the experts 80% of the time. At least had an 80% accuracy rate. The experts was much more, and it took varying fields. The same thing is true with robotic surgery. Mm-hmm. The robotic surgery now is better than the so the dexterity of the robots is better than the human hand. So I'm wondering if they can make the decision better, if they're getting better physical dexterity, what area is going to be safe?
Early retirement.
Well, there's some debate as to whether people will at some point in the future where people will be born and be able to just spend their lives being, you know, waited on by robots, or alternatively whether the robots will consider us to be their pets and hopefully I remember many times thinking that you know if you believed in reincarnation that I would have liked to if I was going to pass away that I would like to have come back as one of my former wife's cats. Because I couldn't think of a better way than to have somebody waiting on me and feeding me and caring for me.
Okay, well thank you so much, Jack. That was really terrific.
Thank you.